some wonder, consider all the works thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and see the blue and feel the gentle then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, oh, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great. God, his son, not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou
shall fail. Good morning, church, and welcome to another morning of Chowdene Connected. We just want to say a big thank you to all who connected with us online at church last week and for all your encouragement and inspirational messages. Keep them coming. Keep connected through all forms of social media. We know people are in isolation, but don't stay isolated. Do FaceTime, pick up the phone, ring somebody, yes, and the good old-fashioned telephone. Pick it up, say hello. I've had some lovely calls this week, so keep them coming. In this current climate, we know that things are a little bit serious. So I'd just like to ask you to watch this inspirational video. Please, watch it carefully, and then we're going to talk to you about it afterwards.
Hello everybody, friends and family. I just wanted to share something that I saw a good idea online. As we know, there's a world shortage of masks due to the coronavirus. And I think we've come up with an alternative idea. It's just a simple thong, everyday thong that, you know, we ladies wear all the time. And I'll just demonstrate. It just goes over the head like that and clips behind the ears. Now, this is a Marks and Spencer's one, but I think, you know, anywhere will do. I know the shops are closed at the moment, but you still probably will get them online. Just to demonstrate, we're all trying to stay safe in the both household. Well, Mama... Oh, yes. That's Rob staying safe. I don't know if my mum's quite got the idea. Mum, we'll have to get you a dig you a thong out. I think Inica's are a little bit too big and slack. So anyway, stay safe, everyone. Bye. Hope this helps.
Thank you. In your presence all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises.
Really glad that you could come and join us again this week. I'm just sorting through my money. One of my hobbies is collecting coins from all around the world, and I've got coins here from Hong Kong, South Africa, the Bahamas, Aruba, America, all sorts of places. Some of them are just really beautiful and interesting. Look at these, that tiny little one with a hole in the middle, and these ones with pretty patterned edges. But interesting though they are, beautiful though they are, these are really what I would just call rubbish money. It's like when you come to the end of the holiday and you've got 37 cents left. Well, what can you do with that? You can't buy anything. It's just rubbish money. Or when you go to a shop and buy something for £19.99, you hand over a £20 note and you get 1p change. Well, what good is that? It's just rubbish money. Or when you have change in your pocket and it's heavy and it's making a hole in your pocket, so you have to take it out and just leave it lying around. It's rubbish money. These two I only picked up last week. They were in America. I was in America, and these were on the car park near Walmart. And you can see somebody's dropped them and then not realised, forgotten about them, and people have driven over them. They're both quite bashed and battered, just rubbish money. Now, supposing I offered you two of these coins or £100, what would you choose? I think most people would prefer to have £100 than two coins that we don't even know what they're worth. But you know, once Jesus said that the two coins were more important than hundreds of pounds. You see, Jesus and his friends were sitting in the temple, and Jesus was watching what was going on. And some rich people were coming in with loads of money, big bags of money, which they were showing around to everybody so that everyone would know that they were really generous, and going and putting them in the temple treasury, in the collection box, bringing in great heavy bags of money and putting them in the collection box so everybody could see how amazingly generous they were, giving so much money to God. And as Jesus watched, a poor widow came in very quietly and just slipped up to the box and put in two coins. Now, those two coins together were worth less than a penny. Jesus called his friends over and he said, look, you see that woman? The money that she's given is worth more than the great bags of money that everyone else was giving. That's crazy, because she just put in such a tiny amount. But the men with big bags of money probably had more bags of money at home, and they wouldn't even notice what they'd given to God. Whereas the woman had given everything that she had to live on. I wonder what she thought to herself when she opened her purse that morning and saw that there were only two coins. She could have thought, oh, I know I should give some money to God, but this is all I've got. So God will understand if I don't give him anything. But she didn't. She could have thought, two coins. Well, I'll keep one and just give one to God. But she didn't. She could have thought, oh dear, only two coins. Well, I'm going to starve to death anyway, so I'll give these to God, and maybe that just means I'll starve to death one day earlier. I don't know if that's what she thought. Or she could have thought, do you know, God deserves everything that I've got. I've only got a little, but I want to give everything that I have to God because he's so amazing. One thing I think she didn't realise that day was that the choice she made would make her so famous that 2,000 years later, people are talking about her all around the world. We can make choices every day as well, and maybe we think that our choices aren't very important. But actually, little things that we do can make a great big difference. I wonder what little things you could do to make a difference in our society at the moment. Perhaps you could be the one that got a group of friends together by Skype and kept in touch with the friends from school. Perhaps you could save up some money and give it for people who haven't got enough food. Or perhaps you can pray about the coronavirus. You might think, oh, there's loads of people praying. It won't make any difference. But who knows? Maybe your prayer will be the one that changes how things go. Now, in your packs this week, you have the story of the widow's offering from the Bible. If you want to find it in your Bibles, it's on page 1018. There's some questions to think about. And a song. Now, this is a modern song, but it might have been the sort of song that the widow was singing in her heart as she gave that money. A prayer activity that'll get you moving all around your house to pray for different things. And then sometimes when we don't have the things that we're used to, we only can concentrate on the things that we haven't got. But this is a game that will help you think on, concentrate on what you have got. It's a scavenger hunt for everyone in your family to take part. Take lots of photos and post the best photo from your family on the WhatsApp group, the parents' WhatsApp group. Then a word search, a picture to colour, and a code to work out. And finally, a craft. You can make a little money box and perhaps start putting some change into that money box to be able to give to help other people. I hope you enjoy doing all that this week. See you next week. Bye.
It's good that although we aren't able to meet physically as a church family, we can join together for this online service. If ever there was a time when we needed to seek God, it's now. So we're going to pray about the situation that's affecting everyone's lives at this time. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, firstly to bring you our praise and worship for who you are, that you are Almighty God, who created all things, that you are all-powerful, that you are unchanging, that you are faithful, and that you have called us into a relationship with yourself through the death of your Son, the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your love for each one of us. We would now pray for our nation and our world at this time and ask for your mercy. We pray for our government and their advisers, that you will guide them as they make decisions to protect and lead our nation. We pray for those working on the front line at this time, in whatever capacity, and in particular our NHS workers, that they would know your protection and your peace. We pray for those who have lost loved ones to the coronavirus, that you would comfort them, that you would bring healing to those who have been infected. We ask that you give wisdom to the scientists who are looking to find a vaccine at this time, and that the virus will be eradicated. We pray also that vital equipment will be made available for medical teams who are treating patients suffering from the virus. We commit to you our church family, from the oldest to the youngest, and ask that you would protect each one of us at this time. We pray that you would comfort those in our fellowship who are grieving the loss of family members, that you would give peace to those who are fearful, bring healing to those who are sick, and for those that are alone, that they may have a real sense of your presence. We pray these things in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus. Amen. To conclude this time of prayer, why don't you join me now in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Morning, and it's good to be with you this week and sharing with you. Welcome to my home, and thank you for welcoming me into your homes this morning. When we look back over the week, you think, well, the week will certainly go down in history. I was thankful for Corinne's sermon last week that reminded us that if we trust in God, all things are possible. And the lovely story of the lady who was healed from being bent over, able to stand up straight. Today I want to talk about a man in the Bible who we have a name for. The lady Corinne talked about last week was nameless, but this man is called Simeon. What a week we've had this week. What a week. Monday we had a beautiful service around the graveside of Betty, Ruth's mum. And the family there were able to bear testimony to her life and share with us her faith and how she had written in her diary. She started to do a diary in 1965, and she, the first page in her diary, she wrote that she hoped her diary would help someone to come and find out who Jesus was. And through her diary, the words bore testimony to her faith in the Lord Jesus. So that was a precious time. And although difficult for the family, we couldn't have a celebration, we couldn't have a service. The service round the grave was really lovely and really meaningful. And we sang some hymns and had a real good time together. And I hope it was a blessing to the family as they laid Betty to rest. The rest of the week, well, we've just grown in anxiety, haven't we? Every day we put the television on and hear the Prime Minister give us an update of where we are. And I was heartened during the week to see when a request was made for 250,000 volunteers, that so far 400,000 have volunteered to come forward and help in some way. It's a great opportunity, isn't it, for to show our Christian faith in caring and loving others. But let's get back to Simeon. Simeon, this man who we don't know an awful lot about, he isn't talked about an awful lot in the Bible, just Luke chooses to mention him and to point out something that he did. So if you've got your Bibles and Luke's Gospel, if you're watching us on the app, there's a little section at the bottom called, in that row that's got chat and prayer and Bible, and you can find the Bible reading. It's Luke chapter 2, verses 25 to 35. And just to remind you, if you want to make comment during this time of the sermon, anything that you think will be constructive or helpful, or even if you think you'd like to tell me something I've said wrong, I'm up for that as well. Just put onto chat. It's great if you do that, because it lets us see that I'm not just sitting here talking to myself. So let's look at Luke chapter 2, verse 25. It says, "Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, 'Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the people. A light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel.' The child's father and mother marvelled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, 'This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. And a sword will pierce your own soul too.'" So they're the words of Luke talking about Simeon. But I want to look a little bit closer at Simeon and just see if we can work out a little bit more about him. The first thing we know is that Simeon, the name Simeon in Hebrew means obedient, listening. In Greek, the name means God receiver. Very appropriate names for the role that God had in mind for him. Spurgeon suggests that Simeon was a high priest, so he was used to being in the temple. And he suggests that he was good at listening to God's Spirit. He was good at hearing the Holy Spirit. And when he was pointed the time was right, he went up into the temple. I guess he was hanging around for some time, wondering when it would be. But when the time was right, he went up into the temple. And the first thing we notice that really stands out about Simeon that I like is that he was obedient. We see in Simeon that he was obedient. He listened to the Holy Spirit. And when he heard it, when he heard the Holy Spirit speaking to him, he did what he was asked to do. He was prompted to go into the temple and he went up into the temple. It says also that he was just and devout. Now, another word we might look at for devout is devoted. He understood the prophecies of the coming Messiah and he was devoted to that hope. He believed in it. He believed that the Messiah would come and that he was devoted to that calling and he was there. It's more than this. Interestingly, Simeon joins a list, a short list of people that actually understood the purpose in the coming of the Messiah. Now, I just want you to think about what that scene looked like in the temple. Here we've got this temple, and I guess you might akin it to, so when a baby's taken into a church to be baptized, and the mother and father go in, and the baby's wrapped up in their baptism gown. And Simeon was taken in by Mary and Joseph, as we know. And when they came in, Simeon recognized who this baby was. And somehow or other, Mary and Joseph gave Simeon, excuse me, the baby to hold. And he made two main points, he said, when he saw the baby. That's a lovely scene, isn't it? It's those of us who've had children and we've been given our babies when we've gone into the hospital to visit, or when we've been introduced to our grandchildren, or when someone we've visited, a friend, has let us hold the baby. It's a very special moment, holding this fragile little bundle in your arms. But when Simeon saw Jesus and had a hold of him, he made two statements. He said, first of all, my eyes have seen your salvation. He could see in that baby what Jesus was going to do, what he was going to achieve. He could see the salvation of Jesus. And then he added something and he said, this isn't just for me, it's for everyone, Gentiles and Jews alike. When you have prepared the face of all peoples, so he was coming to all people. And as Simeon looked at the baby Jesus, his thoughts poured out as he shared with Mary and Joseph the impact of this young child's life. And it says there, Mary and Joseph marvelled at what Simeon said. Now, you'd think, well, Mary and Joseph, you know, they've had the angels appearing to them. They've been seeing God spoken to them that way. Did they not already realise that this was a special baby? Did they not already realise there was something wonderful going to happen with Jesus? But when they heard the words from Simeon, perhaps it was those words that were confirmation to them that he was the chosen one, that something special about Jesus, that he was the anointed one. And they marvelled. And it's amazing, were they just beginning to see what Jesus was about? Or were they just being confirmed what was going on? Simeon had a wonderful privilege of seeing and holding the baby Jesus. He had a wonderful privilege of knowing what that salvation looked like and the privilege of knowing who it was going to be for. Simeon doesn't witness a political movement. He doesn't witness a military revolt to overturn the Romans. As he looked for in that baby, as he looked into the baby, wrapped up in the baby he now holds in his arms, he saw salvation that Jesus was bringing to all. If we look at the life of Simeon, I guess you might wonder, well, that's all we know about him. But isn't that a terrific amount? Isn't that an amazing amount to know about this man's heart, about this man's obedience, about this man's life, about this man's calling from God? If you were to write your biography, what would you write in it? What would you choose to put in your biography? If you were to ask someone to write your biography, who would you choose? Who would I choose? I would want to choose someone, I guess, who would give an accurate view. Perhaps we'd want them to give a good view. We wouldn't want them to put warts and all in. We'd want them to put our best bit in rather than some of our worst bits. Perhaps we'd not want those written about. Who would you choose for a biography? And what would you want to have in? Well, if we take Simeon's example, the good things he had in were this. First of all, we know his name. Not a lot of people in the Bible, we know their names. We know people did things. The seller of purple, different people. We didn't always know their names. But for Simeon, we knew his name. We knew what his purpose was, what his business was. His business was he was more than likely a high priest. But his business was about declaring who Jesus was coming, declaring and waiting for the consolation of Israel. And that's a bit like, I guess, being an evangelist. If you know Jesus is your saviour and you want to tell other people about it, you're declaring the consolation of Israel. You're declaring the joy to the world that Jesus is down to bring. And we know a bit from Simeon now because we know his character. Would we want people to know our character? Would we want them to think of us in the right way? It says of Simeon that he was just and devout. Would we want people to see us as being just and devout, honest in what we're doing, and determined and devoted to telling people about Jesus? And then fourthly, would we want people to know who we hung around with, who our companions were? We know of Simeon that his companion was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit spoke to him. He directed his life. He moved under direction of the Holy Spirit's guidance. Would we want people to know that we were a Spirit-filled person? Or that Stuart, he's a church leader, but he's a Spirit-filled man. I pray that I might live up to being a Spirit-filled man. We've got lots of time to reflect during this time when we're in social distancing. There's lots we have to learn. It's an exercise, isn't it? We've been out on our daily walk this week and we're learning who gives way when you come into a path, who walks onto the road to give you your 2 metres clearance. Is it the person going up the hill? Is the person coming down? Is it this young person? Is it the older person? If there's two of you, do you give way to one person? How does it work? Something we're having to learn. This whole idea of social distancing. It feels really strange, doesn't it? To not be able to go up to people. I found myself watching television and thinking, they're getting far too close. They're not social distancing. They shouldn't be doing that. And we're learning new things. But what I have found is that I'm having a lot more time to reflect on who I am and what I'm about. And I think what I'd like to encourage us to do today is just think, well, was there anything that God told me to do up until a couple of weeks ago? Or he's been telling me for a long time I need to do. Maybe some changes in my life. Maybe some action for somebody. Maybe to go to someone and say, I'm sorry, let's not be falling out, let's be friends again, let's be friends in Jesus. And I've been disobedient, I need to be obedient. Perhaps there's someone that we need to give a gift of money to during this hard time, and something inside of us doesn't feel right to give money away. Perhaps we just have to let go and let God, trust God in our giving as well. And I think as well, this is a time to reflect not just on things that we haven't been obedient to, but on things we might feel we need to be obedient to during this time of social isolation. Perhaps it's just offering some help to someone. Perhaps it's calling someone. Perhaps it's just offering some food, some scones or something, some words of encouragement to someone. Just going to the shop that you do have to go into and being an encouragement to the person who's having to serve behind the till and take a risk of catching the virus from you. Perhaps it's not just about looking back or looking at the time now. Perhaps it's a time to reflect on how things might be different when we come out of this. President Trump seems to think we're going to come out of it in 2 weeks. Other people say 3 months. Some people say it's going to take a year. We can be sure that at some point we are going to come out of it, that nature will take its course one way or the other, that we will have a different situation in a period of time. How do I want to be different? How has this self-isolating, this reflective time made a difference to me? I'd like to think that I have spent some time and I will spend some time thinking, what do I want to do? What's going to be my purpose? I think the most important thing is to spend time with God and the Holy Spirit and ask for guidance. Ask for guidance for the future. Ask for guidance in the next few days. Just how we can cope. And just in closing, I just want to offer a prayer that we may be challenged to sense our worth. Simeon spent a whole life doing things. We don't know anything else about what he did, but we know the important thing he did when he was asked by God to do something. What is your worth? You might think you're worthless, but God has a purpose for you. God has something for you to do. What is our value? What are our unique gifts that only you and I can do for other people? Perhaps you haven't even discovered them. I pray that maybe you'll discover those in the next few weeks, what your unique gifts are. That God can use you in his church and for his glory. Simeon proves we're never too old to do something valuable for God. You're never too old. I'm never too old. You're never too young to do something for Jesus. Let's just pray and seek his guidance so that in the future we can be declarers of the faith. If we know the Lord Jesus in our hearts, why would we not want to declare that faith? Simeon knew the strength and the value of who Jesus was, and he just wanted to proclaim that in the temple, in the Jewish temple of all places. He wanted to declare who Jesus was. Perhaps that's something we're not doing enough of. Maybe this is our opportunity as people get frightened and concerned and worried about the future. We have a future in Jesus. We have a trust in Jesus. We have an anchor that cannot fail. No matter what the storm throws against us, we have an anchor in Jesus. It's interesting that our friends in South Africa, we're talking to them, and they've just gone into lockdown this week as well. And they were locked down on the 26th. And one of my friends read up that it said in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 20, "Go, my people, enter your rooms and shut the doors behind you. Hide yourselves for a little while until his wrath has passed by." And I like the first bit of that we need to just hide ourselves away and just understand who God is, what he's doing, and what he needs to do to speak to you. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we just thank you for this man Simeon. We thank you, we know his name, but even we didn't, we know what he did. He acknowledged you as Lord and Saviour. And Father, help us in the coming week, even in a time of social distancing, to be able to acknowledge you as our Lord and our Saviour. Amen. Bless you all, folks. Have a really good week. Please keep in touch with each other, chat to each other, talk to each other, share what God's doing. But above all, if you need help, seek help from each other. Bless you all. Bye now.
I'm glad you enjoyed that from the booth, that inspirational video. Yes, show me how to do our face thumb mask. I should watch it carefully because we want you to send us your clips of your face thumb mask, and we'll try and show them here on Chowdene Connected throughout the coming weeks. Now, after that little bit of lightheartedness, I'd just like to read you something inspirational. My manager Jen sent me this last week, and it's called Lockdown by Brother Richard. Yes, there is fear. Yes, there is isolation. Yes, there is panic buying. Yes, there is sickness. Yes, there is even death. They say that in China, after so many years of noise, you can hear the birds sing again. They say that after just a few weeks of quiet, the sky is no longer thick with fumes, blue and grey and clear. They say that in the streets of Assisi, people are singing to each other across the empty squares, keeping their windows open, so that those who are alone may hear the sounds of family around them. They say that a hotel in the west of Ireland is offering free meals and delivery to the housebound. Today, a young woman I know is busy spreading flyers with her number on throughout the neighbourhood so that the elders may have someone to call on. Today, churches, synagogues, mosques and temples are preparing to welcome and shelter the homeless, the sick, the weary. All over the world, people are slowing down and reflecting. All over the world, people are looking at their neighbours in a new way. All over the world, people are waking up to the reality, to how big we really are, to how little control we really have, to what really matters, to love. So we pray and we remember that yes, there is fear, but there does not have to be hate. Yes, there is isolation, but there does not have to be loneliness. Yes, there is panic buying, but there does not have to be meanness. Yes, there is sickness, but there does not have to be disease of the soul. Yes, there is even death, but there can always be a rebirth of love. Wake to the choices you make as to how you live now, today. Breathe. Listen, behind the factory noises of your panic, the birds are singing again, the sky is clearing, spring is coming, and we are always encompassed by love. Open the windows of your soul, and though you may not be able to touch across the empty square, sing. I hope you enjoy the rest of the service.
the morning light. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord.
I see all you. Louder! One more time!
I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more the night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. From that morning when this light is over, I'll fly away towards home on God's celestial shore. Joy will never end. I'll fly away. And I'll fly away. Oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. You. Takes me down and I breathe here no more. His anthem will sound on that eternal shore. And I join with the angels in heaven on high, singing praise the Lord, He is alive.